Our mission is to build bridges with a vibrant spirituality that transforms lives and that transforms our world. And in order to do that, we emphasize excellence in ministry. And we believe that as we are able together to do ministry in better and better ways, that that's the foundation for changing the world in the future. So welcome to MCC Toronto and welcome home. Today, we welcome our local MPP, Peter Tabbins. Peter, welcome. And you know that I'm never one to meddle in politics. However, and it's not a provincial campaign, so I'm not showing any bias, but he's one of the good ones. And so, Peter, welcome. Because we are facing a city election and possibly a provincial election in the next little while, and definitely a federal election in the next year plus, a lot of political stuff is going to be happening over the next while. And so we've decided to invite the four federal leaders to come and preach at MCC Toronto about what are the values and principles that guide them in public service. We're not asking them to come and give a campaign speech or a partisan speech, but to let us know what are those principles that guide them. And we think it's important for us to hear. Now, it's quite audacious for a local church to invite four leaders to come and preach. However, we're very pleased to announce this morning that Elizabeth May has said yes, that Thomas Mulcair has said yes, that Justin Trudeau is not available in the dates we gave him, but we're looking at other dates. And we have not yet heard back from the federal, the leader of the Progressive Conservative Party, although, to give him the benefit of the doubt, being Prime Minister keeps you a little busy. And certainly with the death of Jim Flaherty, these are difficult times for him. And so we hope to hear back in a little while. But it's very exciting. And so 2 weeks from today, Elizabeth May will be here to talk about the values and principles that guide her. The following week, Thomas Mulcair will be here to do the same thing, and over time in the future, we'll hear from other leaders. So we're very excited to announce that this morning. And now our executive pastor has some more announcements.
At the Metropolitan Community Church of Toronto, we celebrate the incredible ministry that you have and the angels who make ministry happen here. And this week, we would like you to celebrate the important ministry of our refugee fundraising team. The refugee fundraising team has been working over the last several years to create a number of different opportunities to find creative ways to fund the important ministry. And the funds that they actually help to raise not only help to settle refugees here within Toronto, but also go to provide the important programming resources that we need in order to support people on their spiritual journey, to create community among the refugee community, as well as to help to be with them and walk with them and guide them through the process. I ask now, if you are a member of the refugee fundraising team, please rise as you're able. And I ask everybody if you'll please thank the ministry of Cheryl, Wesley, Michael, Janet, and Alexander. In your worship bulletin this Sunday, you'll find three inserts, three. I ask that you take them out and take a look at them for a minute so that we can look at them together. The first is your connection card. Connection is one of the ways that community really does happen here at the Metropolitan Community Church of Toronto. We ask that you complete this card to let us know that you worship with us every week, and if your name, address, telephone number, or email has changed, to give us those updates. If you're a first-time visitor and would like to get added to our e-newsletter, just give us your email, tick the box at the bottom, and we'll make sure that you're added very quickly. And on the back, you'll also find that there's a place for your prayer requests, as well as your comment cards. Our deacons pray those prayers throughout the week. Today, when the offering plate comes forward, you can just put your comment card, connection card into the plate, and then we'll make sure that it finds its way to the people who can connect you in ways that make sense. You'll also find this green sheet. It is a way for you to honor the memory or to celebrate the life of somebody who you hold dear by sponsoring some of the flowers that will decorate our sanctuary for our Easter celebration next Sunday. We ask that you consider doing that. This Sunday is the last Sunday that you're able to do that so that we can order the flowers, complete that, put it in the offering plate, or you can stop by the information desk following the worship service. And then, this is probably the most important sheet. It has a list of all of the different events that we have going on this week to celebrate Holy Week. There is going to be an interfaith Seder on Wednesday. There's a sign-up and more information in the social hall following worship service. This Seder is being organized by David and Allison Stein. They are the parents of Ben Stein. Ben leads the music ministry and the evening service in our Higher Praise praise team. And so please consider joining us for the Seder. There's also Good Friday here at 7 p.m., as well as a sunrise worship service and our 9, 11, and 7 p.m. worship services next Sunday. All are going to be vibrant celebrations of this holiday for Easter. If you are coming to the 9 and the 11 next Sunday, we encourage you to park at the No Frills parking lot away from the grocery store. We are going to be having a shuttle that will run from 9 until 1 p.m. so that we can make sure that there is space for all of the visitors, your friends and family who are going to be visiting and joining with us for these important celebrations. I now invite you, as you're able, to rise to greet those who are near you and to extend the hand of friendship.
Come, come, O God of life and breath and wholeness, be with us now.
Show us the way to new life and grant us the courage to be people of your way.
Thank you. Jesus, on the first Palm Sunday, you entered the holy city of Jerusalem triumphant and with humility. We ask that you enter our hearts today with your glory, that we may greet you in song, Hosanna, praise, prayer. As your disciples blessed your coming, let us too prepare for a new experience of your love. As we continue to bear our personal crosses, let us also bless your coming. We ask this in the name of God, our Creator. Amen.
My name is Roy Dean. It is my privilege to have been chosen to present this year's MCC Toronto Choir Member of the Year Award. The Choir Member of the Year Award is presented to that member who has been recognized through a vote by his or her peers for an outstanding display of dedication, hard work above and beyond the call, and representing the bedrock core beliefs of our church over the course of the last year. This year's recipient certainly fits all of those categories and more. They are relentless in their mission to improve the experience that is MCC Toronto, a great team leader who rallies the talents of their fellow volunteers to make sure that you and the world know and hear what is going on at MCC Toronto. With an infectious laugh, a patient and bright spirit, true dedication, even when there are burps, bumps, and any number of squeals, Kevin Coutu is a good example to us all. It is not always a simple task to keep the sound functioning for each Sunday service or special event, but Kevin manages it by guiding his team and pushing through, often while holding his head in his hands, but with a smile on his face. We have often seen this dedicated tenor for over 4 years, disrobing to run from the choir loft down to the sound booth to add assistance to his loyal team. As much as I am sad to see he isn't able to sing with us every opportunity, I am surely thankful he is willing to sacrifice his love of singing so the rest of us sound good. Yet he still attends each rehearsal, hoping, beyond hope, that this will be the Sunday he'll get to stay where he started for a whole service. There are those whose talents lie behind the scenes and are often not readily recognized. It would take much longer than the 2 minutes allotted to me to relay all of what Kevin does for us, the choir and the congregation. So here is a list of some of the highlights. He is team leader for the audiovisual team, which encompasses the sound mixing and recording for each Sunday service at 9 a.m. and 11, making sure the message of MCC Toronto reaches the world. He has often pitched in to help with the evening service. Last year, he added host to his repertoire when doing the sound for the well-attended and delightful Month of Sundays afternoon concert events. The brilliant sound for the 4 absolutely wonderful concert fundraising nights called Two of a Kind. Each year, he has coordinated and managed the sound setup and staging for our Church on Church Pride celebrations. Christmas here at MCC Toronto for Lessons and Carols, as well as Roy Thompson Hall. He will be busy all this next week utilizing his artistic and technical skills, serving our needs for Easter. Kevin has a great love of the arts and works tirelessly to improve the experience we all have here at MCC Toronto. I know that our Sundays and all of the special events would not come off as smoothly as if he were not the dedicated choir member he is. He is a loving, caring person, and I am honored to be here to present him with the 2013 Choir Member of the Year Award, Mr. Kevin Coutu.
Song, join the glorious sound. Children.
You are now invited to name people or circumstances as prayer requests out loud during the prayers of the people. Gracious God, your abundance surrounds us and sustains us. We thank you for gifts of friendship and new beginnings, for life as it unfolds and new opportunities for growth, for all action that builds community and support for one another. God of grace, we know you hear our prayers. Spirit of hope, in our lives and in our world, there are many troubled by concerns. Some face the uncertainty and pain of illness. Some wrestle with anxiety and fear about work, about relationships, and about themselves. We pray that your healing love may touch these lives. Donna Lautenbach. God of hope,
we know you hear our prayers.
Spirit of compassion, be with us as we face losses in our lives. Where there is disappointment, lead us to joy. Where there is grief, fill us with your peace. Where there is death, help us to say goodbye for now and not forever. We pray for the family and friends of Jim Flaherty. God of compassion,
we know you hear our prayers.
Breath of the universe, you have created us for joy. Open our minds to the gracious promptings of your spirit. Increase our trust and guide our hearts in the ways of love. God of many names, you transform us by grace and renew us in peace.
A sacred reading from theologian Marcus Borg's blog. On Sunday, Palm Sunday, Jesus entered Jerusalem from the east in a procession, riding on a donkey, cheered by his followers. At the same time, a Roman emperor procession of troops and cavalry entered the city from the west, headed by Pilate. Their purpose was to reinforce the Roman garrison stationed near the temple for the season of Passover. When tens or even hundreds of thousands of Jewish pilgrims filled the city, the contrast between Jesus' entry and the imperial entry sounds the central conflict that unfolds during the rest of the week. Jesus' mode of entry was symbolic, signifying that the realm of which he spoke was a realm of peace. According to the prophet Zechariah, the ruler entering Jerusalem on a donkey was to banish the weapons of war from the land and speak peace to the nations. The dominion of Rome, on the other hand, was based on violence and the threat of violence.
God above.
began to drive out those who were selling and those who were buying in the temple. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. And he would not allow anyone to carry anything through the temple. He was teaching and saying this, Is it not written that my house shall be a house of prayer for all the nations? But you have made it a den of robbers. And when the chief priests and the scribes heard it, they kept looking for a way to kill him, for they were afraid of him, because the whole crowd was spellbound by his teachings. These are sacred readings. May they comfort us, inspire us, and challenge us. Thanks be to God. So from the first reading this morning, you realize now that there were two processions that Palm Sunday. The one procession leading the Roman garrison into the city was a traditional one, for Passover was a time when Jews from all over came to be a part of the celebration in Jerusalem, and the Roman occupiers were afraid that this might be the time of the revolt, so they sent a garrison to shore up the Roman oppressors. Occupiers. Well, at the same time, out of the Eastern Gate, significant because the prophets predicted that the person who would really turn things upside down would come in through the Eastern Gate. So out of the Eastern Gate, Jesus came in, and he was emphasizing a transformational world, but doing so through peace. So you have these two opposite processions. As soon as Jesus got into Jerusalem, he went right directly to the temple. He wasted no time. Now, this story about Jesus overturning the tables in the temple is very interesting because of the four Gospels, four different accounts of the life and the teachings of Jesus. This is one of the very few stories that's in all four. Some other pretty dramatic things, like the raising of Lazarus from the dead, only get in one of the Gospels. Only one person either had heard of it or thought it was significant enough. But this story gets in all four. What was happening was when people came to the temple to celebrate the Passover, they couldn't use the typical coins of the Roman Empire to make a donation to the temple. They had to use a temple currency. And so when they came to the temple, they would take their regular currency. They would trade it in for temple currency, but they had to pay an exchange fee. And this exchange fee, in some cases, was exploitive. And this exchange fee prevented some folks who couldn't afford to be able to get the currency that they wanted. And the same thing was true if you wanted to make a sacrifice, and you wanted to buy a dove to make a sacrifice. You had to do it there and pay a high fee. And so it became a barrier for some. And many people believe that this act of Jesus challenging that and overturning the tables, more than anything else he did, some folks believe that this is what led to people to seek his death. Now, some folks are uncomfortable with this story about the angry Jesus. This is certainly not the meek and mild, gentle Jesus of children's stories. Jesus experienced anger and all of the other emotions that we experience. Jesus cried, he got angry, he ate food, he drank water, he drank wine, he went to sleep. All of the things, the whole range of emotions that we experience. Now, lately you've read some articles about people talking about the possibility that Jesus was married, even this week, about someone has found a fragment that seemed where Jesus seemed to be referring to his wife. And how that seems to get people really, really upset for some reason. But we need to remember that Jesus experienced all of the emotions that we experienced, including anger. Now, not only are some people uncomfortable about Jesus getting angry, but some people are uncomfortable about anger in general. I know when I was a kid, my mom used to say, now don't get angry. Okay? Didn't work, but anyway. And I think one of the reasons why people are uncomfortable with anger is they've never seen healthy anger. They've only experienced anger that's destructive, that lashes out at people, that punches holes in walls or destroys things or relationships. However, in the Bible it says, be angry, but sin not. And so it's important for us to be able to focus on some things and really get angry. But to get angry in a healthy way, it depends on what you're angry about and what you do with that anger. Now, in contrast to Jesus, too many Christians and too many churches and faiths today fall on the side of supporting the status quo. When Constantine made Christianity legal, the church went from challenging the religious establishment, from challenging the political establishment, to being the establishment itself. Here's a wonderful, impish quote from an Episcopal bishop named William Love as he talks about how we've gotten it wrong in terms of our interpretation of Jesus. He says this, "Since then, we have been subjected to heavily theologized, heavily pietized, heavily colonialized, and heavily lobotomized interpretations of Jesus. Rather than embracing an establishment Jesus, we who are faithful to the gospel must also follow the Jesus who got angry. There are social situations in our society today, in our city and in our country and around the world, that should make us angry. And we need to continue to challenge religious and political power when it oppresses or excludes." One of the examples of modern day examples of how this role has been followed is the example of the black church. There's this wonderful book, The Freedom Seekers, Blacks in Early Canada by Daniel Hill. And it talks about the history of individuals and movements and churches challenging the status quo, in some cases deliberately breaking laws in order to be able to bring about justice. It's a tradition in North America that churches have often played a role in either getting people into the Underground Railway and out of the U.S., or being the receptacle in Canada of those who escape and forming communities here in Canada. In many cases, people engaged in illegal activities in order to advance God's call for justice. And historically, black churches have emphasized personal faith, emphasized the power of music in that faith, but have also taken on racism and led demonstrations and stood up against oppression and used music, yes, in terms of personal faith, but also as prophetic witness. We shall overcome. It's not just about overcoming our own challenges. It's also about overcoming systemic evils in our society. 9 years before Rosa Parks stood up, there was a woman in Nova Scotia named Viola Desmond. She lived in Halifax but went to New Glasgow. And in New Glasgow, her car broke down and they told her she'd have to spend the night there before the car would be fixed and she could return to Halifax. And so she decided to go to a movie, 1946. And she went to the movie theater and she asked for a ticket for the main floor, not for the balcony that was the black section in the main floor. She wanted a ticket on the main floor. So she bought a ticket, thinking she had a ticket for the main floor. She went in and sat down. They came to her and said, "You need to move. You don't have a ticket for here." And when she went back to the front desk, they told her, "No, the tickets down there are 1 cent more. And you don't have a ticket," and they wouldn't sell her a ticket for that area. So she proceeded to go back in and sit down where she was on the main floor. She was eventually arrested, assaulted, and charged with tax evasion because that extra penny that she didn't pay had some taxes on it. She was found guilty in court. When she went back to Halifax, her husband encouraged her to just let it go. But when she went to her church, in this case to her Baptist church. They said, no, you need to fight this injustice. And so she did, but she continued to lose in court. And it wasn't until the year 2010 that she was granted a complete pardon and the province of Nova Scotia apologized that she was ever prosecuted in the first place. Where do you think Jesus would have sat? Where would you sit? We are called to follow the Jesus who would take on the injustices, get angry, express that anger against injustice, and take action. The historical Jesus lived in a specific context. He lived as a Jew in the Jewish faith, in the context of the Roman conquest of Israel. Poverty afflicted the masses. Taxes disproportionately impacted the poor. And when people turned to their faith communities for comfort and support, too often they faced corruption, fundamentalism, and exclusionary practices of high fees in order to participate. And the poor were disproportionately affected by all of this. Jesus consistently attacked financial exploitation, religious exploitation, and here in this case, these two things were intertwined and it set him off. He threw out the money changers from the temple. In other words, Jesus was not this airy-fairy spiritual leader who went around trying to convert people. He was a social and spiritual leader who responded to oppression, injustice, and poverty. And great crowds flocked to him. And as a consequence, powerful forces, religious and political, opposed him. I think today Jesus would continue to hold faith communities to a very high standard. And so here at MCC Toronto, we need to constantly examine how we are including and excluding people. For instance, we have men's retreats and women's retreats, adult education courses, and we charge for most of those courses and for those retreats. But how do we make sure that someone's not excluded because of financial reasons, to make sure that we have scholarships and ways to help? We also, recently, when we were doing our renovations, we wrestled with the issue of the main floor washroom. And we looked at other agencies like the 519, where the emphasis is to move towards all gender washrooms, rather than gender-specific washrooms, so that everyone was welcome and no one would have to make a decision about what their gender identification is. And so that main floor washroom is called an all-gender washroom, or someone else gave us the phrase, the all-are-welcome washroom, and everyone's welcome. But we also are mindful that some folks are not comfortable with all-gender washrooms. So if we are truly to practice exclusion, we have to hear that as well. So we have a men's washroom and a women's washroom for those who are not comfortable. Unfortunately, as we go through our continual renovation process, the men's washroom was renovated and made very appropriate, and the women's only washroom downstairs was not. And so I'm going to do something this morning that I don't have permission for, but as I say sometimes to our board of directors, sometimes it's easier to get forgiveness than permission. And they are very great. We've talked about it a bit at the edges. We discussed it once, so I have permission. No, I'm sure the board will all be fine. So it's about the latest estimates we have to finish to do the women's washroom properly is somewhere between $17,000 and $20,000. So I'm going never to miss an opportunity. I'm going to ask the men of the church to give me $20,000 after the service today to fix that washroom. This is the way for the men of the church who've enjoyed a wonderfully renovated washroom to help us promote equality in our church. Okay. So as the women applaud, men of the church, you can see me at the back or in the social hall, write checks. 20 of you do $1,000, 40 of you do $500, whatever you want to do. Let's take care of it. Let's get it done. Okay. Back to my sermon. For us, doing a all-gender washroom was practicing inclusion. And to make sure that there are other spaces is also about practicing inclusion. And if we see Jesus in the context of someone who wanted to include others, then we can get the message. If we don't see him that way, we miss the message. And we end up following him into the church, but not back out into the world. And we need to do both. So I'm going to challenge you this morning that wherever you work or wherever you volunteer, that you should look at the policies and practices that are in place and ask the question, how does this impact people? Who is this including and who is this excluding? And if we really follow this Jesus, we should be the conscience of our companies. And we should be the conscience of our communities. Now, learning how to do this in helpful ways, not being so irritating that no one talks to us or dismisses us, but learning the art of how to challenge institutions to change and to be more inclusive. We, of all people, should be raising these questions. For example, schools in wealthy neighborhoods versus schools in poor neighborhoods. Do they both have equal access to technology, to parents' councils, and to funds? Children being raised by wealthy families compared to children being raised in poor families, an early childhood education. Are we moving towards equality or not? Recent studies have shown us that people in poverty have less access to health care, and therefore their health is less. And just a little example recently with my knee surgery. Great, great care. So thankful for our healthcare system. But there are little things at the edges. The night before surgery, you have to get this special sponge to bath to make sure that you're ready in terms of your cleanliness and not bringing any diseases in. And it costs $5 to buy it at the little store in the hospital. And then when you're ready to leave, they said, do you have crutches at home? I said, no. Okay, here's some crutches. We'll send you a bill for $30. $35, easily be able to afford that. But what about those for whom that may be difficult? How universal is our health care when we charge people at the edges for some of these necessities? These are just some questions that we should be asking and should be looking at as a society. Here at MCC Toronto, I think we've done a good job of including LGBT people. I think we've done a good job of being the conscience for broader Christianity about welcoming LGBT people. We've done a reasonable but not perfect job around gender balance, around disability inclusion and access, around sensitivity regarding racial diversity, around heterosexual inclusion and trans inclusion. And these are all in line with what Jesus taught. We don't just do these things because they're the right thing to do. We also do these things because they're mandated for us if we are really going to follow this Jesus. So I want to end this morning with two questions that I want to push you on. Okay? Remember, comfort us, inspire us, and challenge us. Well, here's the challenge part. I want you to think about what you get angry about. And my guess is if we took the time, and we're not going to, but if we took the time and I said, think about the last time this week when you were angry. My guess is most of us would say things like, you know, my partner said this or said that, or a friend said this, or at work they said that, or someone cut me off in traffic, or whatever, you know, or, you know, something like that that we'd get angry about. And I want to challenge you to be angry about the right things, to look around at the social injustices. You can't fix everything, absolutely. You can't get angry about everything, absolutely. But I want you to get angry about something. I want you to look around at our society and say, what needs to change? How does the world need to be transformed? What do I need to get angry about, and what do I need to take on and champion? So think about what you get angry about. And if you want to join with some other folks in some creative anger, some be angry, but sin not work, then take that connection card and on the back and say, I want to meet with some people and focus on the way we're misusing our environment, or I want to do something about addiction in our community, or what is the issue that you get angry about, and we'll try to pull people together and work together to address it. The second thing, we began the sermon section and the readings by saying there were two parades that day. There were two processions. One from the west that was about firming up the status quo, of making sure things don't change, of holding the power and keeping people in their place. And the second procession was about turning the world upside down through peaceful means, about bringing about the kind of world that God would want, where everyone was welcome and everyone was included. And folks, you can't sit in the pew for the rest of the day. When you leave this building tonight, today, you've got to make a choice of whose procession you're going to be in. And I hope you won't sit on the fence, because to me, the answer is obvious. Jesus said, come and follow me, and we'll change the world together. Amen.
And with that heart full of love, Jesus showed us a way to relationship with God, a way that frees us from whatever binds us, reconciling us with God, with each other, and with ourselves. And so, together, we pray. God,
your grace liberates us from the past, frees us from sadness, releases us from guilt. Your love inspires us to sing a new song. As we embrace the beauty within us, in others, and in you, we open our hearts again to the renewal, the forgiveness, and the freedom you offer.
My friends, hear the good news. Hear God saying to us, behold, I make all things new. In every moment, you are loved, and so you are forgiven, free in the name of God who created you, who dwells within you, and who goes with you always. Amen. Please feel free to come forward for anointing for healing.
Thank you.
In addition to the regular offerings of our church, we have three special funds where folks contribute $10 a month to those funds if they choose, over and above the regular offerings. They are our benevolence fund, and that's a fund that the deacons manage for anyone in our church that's in financial difficulty. If we can help out, that's the purpose of that fund. The second fund is our refugee fund to support both sponsoring new refugees, but also covering to making sure we continue to grow our overall refugee program. And the third, the oldest, is our community outreach partner fund. We can't do everything in the city, but we can support great organizations that are doing great work. And so this morning I want to thank, I'm going to thank all of you who contribute to any one of those three funds, not just the COP. So if you contribute to any of those three funds, could you just wave at me? Can you thank these folks, please? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. In my sermon, I addressed the Underground Railroad, that its purpose was to get people out of danger into a safe place. And in order to do that, there were safe houses along the way, and there were communities to settle them as well. And a wonderful coincidence this morning is that we're giving a community outreach partner grant of $5,000 to the Rainbow Railroad. And the Rainbow Railroad helps individuals to escape imminent danger in their countries where governments tolerate and in many cases support violence against them. They assist people by helping them to find safe houses in their countries, providing funding to get them into hiding, expenses and assistance, and document support and transportation to get them to a safe donation. And just in 2013, that one 12-month period, the Rainbow Railroad here in Toronto provided financial assistance and support to 22 individuals who escaped violence in their countries and provided advice to countless others. So they are doing life-saving work. And oftentimes they're able to help people to get to Canada, where then our refugee program can help to care for them and settle them in the country. And so today we have one of our own from MCC Toronto, who is the chair of the Rainbow Railroad. And I'd like to invite Michael Batista to come and receive the donation and to address us.
Yay. Thank you. You get a picture first.
I have a check, a real one. Here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
On behalf of all the volunteers at Rainbow Railroad, and most importantly, on behalf of all the LGBT people at risk of persecution around the world, we really, really thank you. It seems a bit crude almost to assign a monetary value to what we do, but we found that it costs about $2,000 per person to take someone from a place of danger to a place of safety. So we want to let you know that really, this really represents two people that you've saved. So I thought with that in mind, I would give you a couple of examples of people who are working on behalf of to save them. One person is a gay man with a 14-year-old son from Jamaica. And he lives in a rural part of Jamaica with his son, and he was chased out of the community and beaten by community members. He's in hiding right now. He's lost his job. We're working on a way of getting him to a place of safety. The other case that we're working on is the case of a gay man from Uganda. And as you may know, the media have been very active in persecuting the LGBT community in Uganda. So he too is in hiding, and we're working hard to try to get him out to a place of safety. So we are very confident this is going to go a long way to helping us get these two individuals to safety. There's a Hebrew saying that crudely goes, a person who saves one life saves the world. And I just wanted to let you know that you have saved two worlds with this. So thank you very much.
So the folks who contribute to these funds do over and above the regular giving. And now it's time for the rest of us to take care of the regular giving. So in a few moments, the ushers will come by to receive your regular offerings and your connection cards. But sit back now and enjoy this musical offering.
as I lay sleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, I thought the voice of angels from heaven answering. I thought the voice of angels from heaven answering. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, lift up your gates and sing. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to your King. And then I thought my dream was changed, the earth no longer rang. Hushed were the glad hosannas, the little children sang. The sun grew dark with mystery, the morn was cold and chill, as the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. As the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, hark how the angels sing. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to your King. And once again the scene was changed, no earth there seemed to be. I saw the holy city beside the tideless sea. The light of God was on its streets, its gates were open wide, and all who would might enter, and no one was denied. No need for moon or stars by night, or sun to shine by day. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away.
Let us pray. God, we offer you these gifts out of our abundance to your work in this community and from this community. Your love frees us to be generous with each other and inspires us to action as we build bridges in this place and from this place to a world hungry for hope, for justice, and for peace. And so we commission these gifts to your service in the world. Amen. I saw the New Jerusalem, whose gates were open wide, and all who would might enter in, and no one is denied. We try to practice that here at MCC Toronto through an open communion. We do not require that you're a member of this church or any church. We believe that this is God's table, and that whosoever will may come. And so, whether it's in the balconies or here in the main floor, when the invitation is given by the ushers, please know that you're welcome to come by yourself or with a friend to receive the elements. And if you don't want to receive the elements but you want to receive a blessing, just do this as you approach the server and they will give you a blessing instead of the elements. God is with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is a right and good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, loving God, creator of heaven and earth. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with all the company of heaven, who forever sing to proclaim the glory of your name.
Proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died.
Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
These are the gifts of God, and we are the people of God. All are welcome to come and receive. Amen.
Amen.
Can I have some, Linda?
most of the refugee members at MCC Toronto made their refugee claims from within Canada. Predominantly, their homelands are Africa, the Caribbean, and Eastern Europe.
My name is Olatunde Kolajebutu. I'm from Nigeria. A place like MC Toronto would not exist in my country because you could be attacked by the mob knowing that you are associated with such a community and you could face a 14-year jail term from the government if caught. I'm so thankful for Canada and MC Toronto for all you have done to save one more life.
Our refugee sponsorship program helped 5 refugees in 2013, but our funds are now running low, and we will have difficulty sponsoring anyone in 2014 without additional help. There are 78 countries in the world where human rights for LGBT citizens are in peril. Most are in Africa, the Middle East, or the Caribbean. Some countries even impose the death penalty for being LGBT. These refugees escaped persecution in their home countries and lived without status in a nearby foreign land for 18 to 48 months, waiting for a place like MCC Toronto to take them in. Our sponsorship fund pays their living expenses for up to 1 year, which is approximately $1,000 per month. Resources are now running low, as the fund's growth has only been $400 per month. We are asking you today to consider helping us increase our refugee support dollars, allowing us to sponsor 1 new refugee per year. We need to triple our current monthly donations to this fund to be able to save lives. Please be sure to select Refugee Sponsorship Fund to ensure the money goes to the proper account.
Julia, I tell you,
whatever you did for one
of these brothers
and sisters of mine,
you did for me.
For me.
For me.
We need your help now. Please help save lives.
follow Jesus out of the church into the world and join that grand procession of transformers who want to transform the world into being a just place and a peaceful place and a hopeful place. So go and get angry. Look around you and get angry, but sin not. And you know, it wouldn't be a bad thing if MCC Toronto became known as the Angry Church. If we were angry about the right things, and if we handled it the right way. The world needs us. And as you go from this place, go knowing that God's blessings go before you, that God's face will shine upon you and be gracious unto you, and God will grant you peace. You're going out and in your coming in your lying down and in your rising up, in your labor, in your leisure, in your laughter, and in your tears, until that day in which there is no dawning and no sunset, no death and no disease. Go now rejoicing that God loves you. Amen. Thank you for being with us today. The slide will tell you some of the things that are happening in the social hall. Please join us for refreshments. Men, money. Okay? Men, money. And so you can take the offering envelope in the pew. You can use your credit card. You can write it on. You can see me there or there. But men, money. Okay? We want to take care of this today. One of our deacons and Leanne Horvath will be available in our new conference room for 15 minutes following the service for first-time visitors and anyone looking to connect. The question for next Sunday is, are you really, really ready to live? Are you ready to walk out of the dead places and live? Thank you. Yes, yes. See you on Good Friday. Powerful service Good Friday evening and any of the services on Easter Sunday. Let's join together and sing our closing song.